Hello everybody. Welcome to the session on classical encryption techniques. This topic is part of the subject cryptography and network security, which is offered for 7th semester BTech computer science students under the curriculum of APJ Abdul Kalam Technological University. So in this session, we'll be talking about the classical encryption techniques, that is substitution techniques, followed by the transposition techniques in the next part. So, coming to the introduction part, the term cryptography is derived from the Greek word crypto plus graphy. Crypto means secret, graphy means writing. So, cryptography is a science of communication over untrusted communication channels. Historically, it has been associated with spies, governments, military, and even it was used during warfare for thousands of years. So at that time, it was just a medium for communication between entities or between persons without the knowledge of a third person. Okay, so that was the only intention. But over the past 50 years, it has moved its arena from military application to commercial applications. So it has acquired a sound mathematical foundation. So this lecture, it attempts to give an overview of this broad as well as a specialized topic. So I'll start with an example. Consider an e-commerce scenario where you have Alice as a purchasing agent and Bob is her supplier. So what are the requirements for the transaction? These are the requirements that any transaction would prefer. Alice wants to be sure that she is really dealing with Bob and not an imposter. Then Bob wants to know that Alice is really Alice and not an imposter, because Alice gets special prices as negotiated. Then Alice wants to keep the order secret from her competitors, and Bob does not want other customers to see Alice special prices. Then both Alice and Bob want to be sure that the hackers cannot, or a third party cannot, change the price or quantity. And Bob wants to ensure that Alice cannot later claim that she did not place the order. So if you are reading through, or if you are going through these requirements, you can see that this is a requirement that is needed for any transaction. So what you have seen in the bracket is authentication, privacy, integrity, non-repudiation. So the basic definition of all these things. Authentication is the sender knows that the message is going to the intended recipient, and the recipient knows that the message was sent by the proper sender. Privacy, the message is secret, that is only the sender and the intended recipient knows its content. Integrity means the message was not modified, either intentionally or accidentally, while it is in transit. And non-repudiation, the author of the message cannot later deny having sent the message. So these are the general requirements. And in order to ensure that all these requirements are met, we make use of cryptographic techniques. That is, cryptographic techniques can be used to satisfy the above requirements. Now, how does it work? How does cryptography work? It basically makes use of encryption algorithms and decryption algorithms. So, an ordinary message that is called the plain text, it is processed by an encryption algorithm to produce a scrambled message that is called the ciphertext. So, scrambling the message, the purpose is to ensure that a third party will not understand what is communicated between the other two persons. So that is a basic intention of encryption. That is the basic intention of cryptography, secret writing. So the receiver, after doing these encryption, the receiver uses a matching decryption algorithm to recover the plain text from the ciphertext. So there would be no security if these algorithms were known to everyone. So definitely everybody will know which are the prevailing encryption algorithms. And what is the security? The security, of course, lies in what you call as a key. The key is secret, even though many people may know the algorithms. Now, there are two basic types of encryption techniques. The first one is called secret key cryptography or symmetric cryptography, and the second one is called a public key cryptography or asymmetric cryptography. Okay, now what do you mean by the symmetric cryptography? Here, both encryption and decryption operations use the same key. That is, the secret key, the sender and the receiver, they'll be using the same key for encryption as well as decryption. Whereas in asymmetric cryptography, they make use of two keys. Okay, one is made public, that is called the public key, while the other key is kept secret. So there is a public private key pair. Okay, so the sender and the receiver. The receiver knows its corresponding private key, and both the sender and the receiver knows the public key. So that is the concept of public key cryptography, or otherwise called asymmetric cryptography. So this is a representation of symmetric cryptography. So here you have a plain text input, and the sender and the receiver, they make use of the same key. That is, the key is shared between the sender and the receiver. So it's called the shared secret. And the sender encrypts this plain text to get the ciphertext. And the receiver will decrypt the ciphertext to using the same key to get back the plain text output. So this is symmetric cryptography. Now, what is asymmetric cryptography? In asymmetric cryptography, you have two different keys. One is the public key, and the other one is the private key. And what the sender does is, the sender encrypts the plain text using the public key and converts it to ciphertext. The receiver decrypts the ciphertext using the private key to retrieve the plain text back. So you have a public key private key pair to encrypt as well as decrypt the messages. So this is asymmetric cryptography. Now, what is the practical use? In practice, cryptographic systems often use both secret key and public key cryptography together. Okay, secret key algorithms or the symmetric key algorithms, they are usually faster and is more efficient to use to encrypt the actual data. So normally what happens is, the system first generates a random key for the secret key algorithm. So this key has to be communicated to the receiver, right? Because they share the key. So even that key also can be compromised. That can be seen by a third party. In our case, normally in cryptography, the actors who play in cryptography are Alice, Bob, and Eve. Where Eve is the enemy. Okay. So when Alice and Bob are sharing a key, Eve can definitely intercept and see what the key is. So you have to hide the key from Eve. At that time, you can make use of a public key algorithm. So that is what is mentioned. The system generates a key, then the system encrypts that key using the public key algorithm. So you are taking a combination of symmetric as well as asymmetric key algorithms in practical use. So you will be studying more about this as we move on. So that is a particular area of study, cryptanalysis. Now, the last one is cryptology. Cryptology, it is a field of both cryptography and cryptanalysis. So these are some basic terminology that you should be aware of when we step into the subject of cryptography. So next is a symmetric cipher model. So as we have already studied, a symmetric cipher is, or a symmetric encryption algorithm is an algorithm where the sender and the receiver use the same private key, same key for encryption as well as decryption. So a generalized model for this is, you have a plain text input, you have an encryption algorithm. An example they have given is DES, that is data encryption standard. And there is the secret key that is shared between the sender and the receiver. You can see the secret key. So plain text, the algorithm, the secret key. By applying this algorithm with the help of the secret key on this plain text, you are converting it to ciphertext and you are transmitting it to the receiver. When the receiver receives the ciphertext, the receiver applies the decryption algorithm, which is the inverse of encryption algorithm, and the receiver also makes use of the same secret key, and the receiver retrieves the plain text output. So this is a symmetric cipher model. Now going to the requirements. So there are basically two requirements for the secure use of symmetric encryption. One is a strong encryption algorithm, definitely. So that our aim is nobody except the sender and the receiver is able to read or discover the message or the key. That is our ultimate aim. And second requirement is the secret key is known only to the sender and the receiver. So mathematically, we'll be writing like, suppose X is the plain text, E is the encryption algorithm, K is the key that is shared between the sender and the receiver, then E is the encryption algorithm, D is the decryption algorithm, and Y is the ciphertext. I repeat, X is the plain text, Y is the ciphertext, E is the encryption algorithm, D is the decryption algorithm, and K is the secret key that is used for both encryption and decryption. So you will be writing like EK of X, applying the encryption algorithm using the secret key K on X gives you the ciphertext Y. This is encryption. And decryption is you are recovering the plain text back from the ciphertext. That is, you apply the decryption algorithm using the same key K on the ciphertext Y. So here, we assume the encryption algorithm is known. That means you need a very secure channel to distribute the key. So you will be studying about key management techniques and key distribution techniques as we move on. So currently, for the time being, we stress on the importance of keeping the key secret and managing the key in such a way that nobody else other than the sender and the receiver knows the key. Now, cryptanalysis. So as I had already mentioned in that terminology slide, cryptanalysis is the method by which an attacker is trying to know something about the key as well as the plain text. So here, the objective is to recover the key, not just the message. So the attacker, if he gets an idea of the key, maybe he can analyze the remaining messages that are sent between these two people, and he can use that same key to decrypt it. So the ultimate aim of cryptanalyst is to recover the key. So two general approaches are there. One is the cryptanalytic attack, and second one is the brute force attack. What do you mean by cryptanalytic attacks? Cryptanalytic attacks means these are the different types of cryptanalytic attacks. That is, ciphertext-only attack, non-plain text attack, chosen plain text attack, chosen ciphertext, and chosen text attack. So in all these cases, what the attacker has in hand is either he has a ciphertext only. Sometimes he will be having a known plain text and the corresponding ciphertext. At times he will be he has the freedom to choose a plain text of his choice, and he can get the corresponding ciphertext. Okay. Similarly, he has an option to choose a ciphertext and try to get the plain text corresponding to it. Okay. So in each of these cases, the attacker, with the resources in his hand, is trying to make out what is the key. Is there any relation between the key and the ciphertext and the plain text? Is there any method for me to know from a particular message what the key is or what the original text is? So these are the different methods. In ciphertext only attack, the attacker only knows the algorithm and he has a ciphertext with him. So this is purely statistical. Okay. And with that, trying to analyze the nature of ciphertext and the nature of the algorithm, he is trying to find out a plain text. That is ciphertext only attack. Second one is known plain text. That is, here the attacker has some idea about the plain text. He either knows or he suspects a plain text and the ciphertext. Then a chosen plain text means the attacker somehow got a freedom or got a privilege to select a plain text and obtain the ciphertext. Maybe he wants to crack something that was sent by his employer or his boss to another person. So when he got an opportunity to look into his system or look into his encryption algorithm, he'll be just trying out some messages and get the ciphertext. So he has a plain text ciphertext combination with him. That is the known plain text as well as chosen plain text. Chosen ciphertext means he'll be selecting a ciphertext and trying to obtain a plain text from it. And chosen text means either he can select a plain text or ciphertext to encrypt or decrypt. So these are the cryptanalytic attacks. The next one, what we are concerned is, see, when you are designing an algorithm, how can you tell that the algorithm is secure? So in order to tell more precisely what our algorithm should satisfy, you have to know about two more definitions. That is, an encryption scheme should be unconditionally secure and computationally secure. What do you mean by unconditional security? Unconditional security means no matter how much computer power or time is available, the cipher cannot be broken, since the ciphertext provides insufficient information to uniquely determine the corresponding plain text. That is, when an attacker observes the ciphertext, he should not get even a minute information regarding the plain text. It should be in such a way that how much ever time or power you spend on that ciphertext, you are not able to get even a single bit plain text from that ciphertext. That is what you call unconditional security. Second one is computational security. That is, given limited computing resources, the cipher cannot be broken. That is, time needed for calculation is greater than the age of universe. So to be more precise, what do you mean? What is the criteria to be satisfied by an encryption algorithm? An encryption algorithm should meet one of the following criteria. The cost of breaking the cipher exceeds the value of encrypted information. That is, the attacker is trying to make out what the original text is. But after getting the plain text, the cost that you get from that is, there is no point in breaking it. That should be the first one. That means the encryption algorithm should that much be strong to produce such a strong cipher. That is the first requirement. Second one is the time required to break the cipher, it exceeds the useful lifetime of the information. See, suppose you want an information which is fresh only for 1 week, okay, or maybe 1 hour. If you are able to break the cipher or if you are able to get the plain text or key after 2 hours, then what is the point in breaking it? So if your cipher, your encryption algorithm is strong enough to satisfy these two criteria, then definitely you can call it as a strong algorithm, so that no attacker can even play or find anything with the ciphertext to get an information about the plain text. Next is the brute force search. So we were talking about two attacks. First one was cryptanalytic attack. Second one is brute force search. Brute force search is nothing but, you know, in symmetric algorithms, you have a shared key. So key has a prominent role here. So the attacker will sit and try out all the possible key combinations. Suppose he gets an idea that, okay, this key is an 8-bit key. So what the attacker does is, he'll be trying all the combinations with these 8 bits, all the permutation and combination, and he will be able to come up with a particular key. That is brute force search. So brute force searches, it's always possible to simply try every key. This is the most basic attack, and this is actually proportional to key size. So I just gave an example of an 8-bit key. Okay, 8-bit key means it is very simple. Even a small child could even try out and figure out what the key is. But our aim is the attacker should sit for some sufficient amount of time to retrieve the key. So the key size should be large. That is a requirement actually. Okay, and this is just a table that tells you how much time does it take for these key sizes, 32-bit, 56-bit, 168-bit, etc. So you can just go through that. So now moving on to our main topic of this session, what are the classical encryption techniques? So classical encryption techniques means the techniques that were used years before in order to perform this encryption. So some has some mathematical background behind it. Others do not have any mathematical background. It is just a matter of shifting the letters or substituting or transpositioning the letters. Okay. So there are two basic building blocks of all encryption algorithms. Okay. So one is the substitution techniques and the second one is the transposition techniques. Substitution techniques, here the letters of plain text are replaced by other letters or by numbers. That is substitution. You know, substitution means it is replacement. Whereas transposition means you are just changing the position of the letters. You are just permuting the order. Okay. So those are the two classical encryption techniques. So here we will be discussing about substitution techniques. These are the substitution techniques: CISA cipher, monoalphabetic cipher, Playfair cipher, Hill cipher, polyalphabetic cipher. In that, you will be studying about Wigner cipher, then a one-time pair of this. In this part one, we will be discussing only till Playfair cipher. The rest of the ciphers, along with transposition techniques, is dealt in part two of this session. Okay. So, what is CISA cipher? This is the earliest known substitution cipher and it was used by Julius Caesar. So here, this Caesar cipher replaces each letter with the letter standing three places further down the alphabet. That is, A will be replaced by B. See, what is the relation between A and B? B is standing three places down A, right? A, B, C, D. So, like that, if I take each alphabet, M, P is lying three letters downward, M, that is M, N, O, P. E is substituted by H, again E is substituted by H, T with W, and so on. Y, when it comes to these letters, that is Y, you are again finding it as a circular one, because three letters down the line means Y, X, Y, Y, Z, right? So, Z, A, B. Okay? So, that is how it works. The CISA cipher. This is just an example. Meet me after the toga party is the plain text. And using the CISA cipher, you substituted each letter with another letter. And you got the cipher text. Okay? I can decide the value of k as k is equal to 10. So that means if I am considering B, with what letter should I substitute that to? So how will I find that? B takes the value numerically 1. So I will be adding 10 to this 1. So 1 plus 10 gives you 11. And what is 11 mod 26? 11 mod 26 is 11 itself. So you will be taking the corresponding character to the character corresponding to 11, which is L. So B will be converted to L. So what will X be converted to? X takes the value 23, right? So you will be adding 23 and 10 to get the value 33, right? And what is 33 mod 26? 33 more 26 is 7, right? That is, when you divide 33 by 26, the remainder that you get is 7. What is the character corresponding to 7? H. So X will be replaced by H. So in general, you can consider this as a shift cipher, so that you can make this key as secret. Okay, and once you have made this a secret, the key is how many letters to be shifted, that is decided by the sender and the receiver. Okay, so a particular category of shift cipher is actually CISA cipher, where you are taking the value of K as a fixed value, which is 3. So this was used years before, and you can talk about the decryption also. Like from the ciphertext, if you subtract that key, you will get the corresponding plain text. So the normal, the reverse operation. So coming to the cryptanalysis, cryptanalysis means how much easy is for an attacker to find out what the key is. It's very easy, because see, suppose he has a ciphertext with him, because the attacker only gets a ciphertext, right? So he has a ciphertext, so GCUA, and what he will try is, which are the possible combinations? He'll be first trying K is equal to 1. That is, he'll be doing G minus 1. That is the corresponding value of G, minus 1, and you will be performing mod 26. So every operation is mod 26, because you want the answers to be in the range 0 to 25. Otherwise, we don't have an option, right? Because you always want to bring in all the characters, 26 characters in the range 0 to 25. So here, he'll be going for a brute force attack, and he'll be trying all the possible keys. So he'll be trying, okay, if K is equal to 1, what will be the corresponding plain text? And he keeps on doing this until he gets a legible plain text, which he finds it as a as an okay, or this might be the plain text that was done between the sender and the receiver. So a simple brute force search will help you to get all the idea about the key. So here you can consider the cipher as a very weak cipher. Okay, now the next one type of cipher, see, remember, these were the ciphers that were used years before. Okay, maybe at during that time, that might be a strong one, but later on, as years went on, people are trying to make out what is happening. At that time, the concept of cryptanalysis comes in, and you are concerned with the strength or weakness of the key or the encryption algorithm, and they come up with an alternative for this. So the next type of algorithm is a monoalphabetic cipher. Monoalphabetic cipher means this is also a substitution technique. Here, rather than shifting the alphabet, like A is shifted to D or B is shifted to E, you know, there is a permanent shifting. So if you get one particular correct shifting, then you are able to make out all the other plain text characters, which is actually a weakness. Whereas in this monoalphabetic cipher, you are taking a random substitution. There is no shifting, nothing. There is no relation between the plain text and the cipher text. You are randomly saying, see, if A is the plain text, substitute it with B. If B is the plain text, substitute it with A. There is no relation between. It is not like if you add this much to this, you will get this, nothing. That was what happened in CISA cipher, right? But in monoalphabetic cipher, nothing of that sort. Randomly substitute a particular plain text character with any other character. So you could just shuffle or jumble the letters arbitrarily. Each plain text letter maps to a different random ciphertext letter. So Z is mapped to N, U is mapped to O, and so on. So given a plain text, if we wish to replace letters, this is a plain text. So So I have my key that is communicated, that is, this will be known to both the sender and the receiver. Okay, that is, if I am giving it, is just like we if you want to communicate something with your friend and nobody else should know that, you tell that, okay, this character means this character. So you are taking a permanent substitution. So here, what the sender does is, this is the code word that is acceptable to both sender and receiver. If I get I, you will be substituting it with W. If you are seeing F, that will be substituted with I. If you are seeing W, that will be substituted with R, and so on. Random substitution. And once the receiver receives the ciphertext, what will he do? He'll be checking for cipher. Okay, if the cipher is W, then its corresponding plain text is I. So he'll be writing I here. If the cipher is I, the corresponding plain text is F. Okay, he'll be writing F here. Similarly, he'll be decoding all the ciphertext characters with this table that is known only to sender and the receiver. So this was monoalphabetic cipher. Okay. So can you find any problem with the cipher? In a single look, it looks fine, but the problem is, suppose you are considering this letter E. How many times did E repeat in this particular sentence? E comes here, E is here, 2, 3, 4, 5. When you are seeing E in all these places, you can see that they are all substituted to F. So it is easy for an attacker to know that, okay, see, this this is some character that is repeated again and again. Similarly, you can see two T's, they are substituted with U. So there is actually a one-to-one correspondence between the plain text and the ciphertext character. That is the problem with this cipher. So we might think that there are 26 factorial combinations, because today I will be giving a substitution table, A is substituted to D. Tomorrow I will be telling A is substituted to Y. Then so I have different 26 combinations. So 26 factorial is the number of keys. Is that what we meant? But again, we are not building a strong algorithm. The reason is, the language is the cheater here. See, when you are considering English language, in English, some letters are not equally commonly used. There are some letters or alphabets that are used very frequently, and some alphabets are used very rarely. Some examples given are, in English, E is the most commonly used letter, followed by T, R, N, I, O, A, S. This is an analysis that is made based on the language characteristics. Okay. And other letters like Z, J, K, Q, X, they are fairly rare. Okay. So this is a graph that you can see. E is the most widely used, followed by, based on this graph, you were able to come up with such a statistics. Okay. So this can be easily made use of by the attacker. What the attacker does is, he will be trying to see. Suppose the attacker knows a ciphertext. Okay, this is a ciphertext that is known to the attacker. He knows nothing else. He wants to find the plain text, and he knows that the communication is in English language. So what will he do? He'll be exploiting this redundancy property of English language, and he will try to make out the count of characters. See, the relative letter frequencies. So he understood that the P, letter P and Z are coming at so many places here. Okay, I can see P here, I can see P here, then I can see Z here. So P and Z have a relatively higher count when compared to others. So according to our redundancy, we are telling like an English language, the most commonly used letter is E followed by P. So I just do a guessing like, okay, then P will be equivalent to E and Z will be equivalent to T. Okay. Similarly, you can find ZW at so many places, that combination. are such combinations, you call it as digram, digram. Digram means a combination of two letter. So you can see some digrams and some trigrams also. It's a WP. That is what you call a combination of three letters is called trigram. So you can find some combination of two letter, three letter and all. So from these two, the attacker can guess, okay, that means Z is T, then W is H and E is E. That means the. You got one part of a plain text, right? So wherever you find ZWP, you are doing a wild guess based on this language redundancy. You're substituting it with D. So here, he has got one part of the plain text. And at that time, I can make out like wherever I find these ciphertext characters, I'll be substituting it with TH and E. That means by trial and error, ultimately the cryptanalyst or the attacker, he can make out what the plain text is. So the main point is, see, the time taken by the attacker to find out this text, okay? If it is more than the useful period of that, then our algorithm is strong. Because after 2 days, if you are trying to find out this information, there is no point in it. That is what we meant, two criteria to be satisfied. Okay. If the lifetime of your required information, it is already over when you have discovered the message, then there is no point in discovering. So, this particular monoalphabetic substitution has a disadvantage because of this language redundancy. So, we again conclude like, or we again come up to a fact that it is not the key size alone. Even the language redundancy also can try to bring up some issues related to this. Next is a Playfair cipher. Okay, we have already talked about the CISA cipher. Next is a the next cipher was a monoalphabetic substitution cipher. The third one is a CISA cipher. A Playfair cipher. A Playfair cipher, it was an approach to improve the security by encrypting multiple letters. So the previous case was monoalphabetic substitution. Okay. Here, one alphabet was substituted with another alphabet, but their relationship was fixed. That is, wherever in the text you have A, that will be substituted with one letter. Wherever in your text you have B, that will be substituted with another letter. Okay? So, in Playfair cipher, you are taking a combination of two letters, digrams, and then you are trying to substitute it with another letter or number, or here we are basically talking about letters or alphabets. Okay, so here the cipher treats digrams in the plain text. Digrams means a combination of two characters is called digram, a single unit, and translates these units into cipher text digrams. That is, if I have a two letter combination, I'll be converting it to another two letter combination. So a plain text digram is converted to a ciphertext diagram. This is an interesting cipher. You have to only follow some rules. So here also, we need our main thing, that is the key. A key that is shared between the sender and the receiver. So here, even though we have a combination of letters, very easily you can convert it to numbers also, because you are associating alphabets A to Z with the numbers 0 to 25, more 26. Okay, anyway, coming to this one, here the keyword that is used is monarchy. You can see this example in the textbook, the William Stalling's textbook, which is a reference textbook for this one, William, the Cryptography and Network Security by William Stalling. So in that you can see the same example itself. So monarchy is the keyword that is used by the sender and the receiver. With the help of this keyword, you have to construct a Playfair key matrix. This is a Playfair key matrix. Okay. So, you are supposed to create, you want to accommodate 26 characters, right? So, you build a 5x5 matrix. That means you will be able to accommodate 25 characters. So one character will be extra. That is what is seen here. In one particular cell, you can find two characters adjusted. So that is an adjustment that is needed. But still, the general method is, given a particular key, you will be building a 5x5 matrix of letters. It is based on that keyword. Now, how do you construct it? The thing is, you will be writing this keyword like this. You have to avoid any duplicates, if any. That is, if there are two O's, then you need to write only one O like that. So, MONARCHY. Okay, that is 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There are 8 letters in the keyword. So, you have written 8 letters like this, row wise. Once this is over, you have to fill in the remaining cells of this matrix. How will you do that? You will be filling the remaining letters other than these letters in that order. That is, from this onwards, I want to fill in A to Z, but no repetition. Look here, can I put A here? No, because A has already been there in the keyword. So, I'll be next going for B. Then I'll be checking, did C come here? Yes, C has come here. What about D? No. So, I'll be filling it with D. E, F, G. Again, what about H? H has already been part of the keyword. So, you will be going to the next one. Normally, I and J are placed in the same cell. So, that is the principle that is followed. So, I, J, that is placed here. Then I have K here, okay. Then L, next is M, N, O. Both are, 3 of them, M, N, O. They were part of the key. So, you will be continuing with P, okay, which was not part of our keyword. So, P, Q, R was already here. So, you skip R, S, T, U, V, W, X, and Y was already here. So, Z. You accommodated all the characters into 5x5 matrix. To accommodate the 26th character, there is an adjustment in this cell. So, this is how you generate a Playfair key matrix. A 5x5 matrix of letters based on a keyword is used. Then you fill in the letters of the keyword without duplicates. Fill rest of the matrix with other letters. So, here you have taken an example, monarchy. Okay. Now, once you have done that, then you will be doing encryption and decryption based on these rules. Look at the rules. You are taking 2 characters at a time. Okay. So, the rules that you have to follow is, suppose if a pair has a repeated letter, then you have to insert a filler like X. That is, suppose you have to encrypt the term balloon. So, look here. You have L, L, O, O, that is repeated letters. Then you will have to insert a filler in between them. So, given a plain text, you will have to divide them into diagrams, that is a group of 2 characters. And you will be converting that 2 character, that is a diagram, plain text diagram, to a ciphertext diagram. So, when you are dividing them into 2, BA is fine. Next is LL, that means you have 2 letters or 2 equal letters coming together, repeating. Then you have to add a filler. So, what you do is, you will be doing LX. X is a filler. Okay. So, when you fill that, again you will be left with LO. So, LO is the next diagram. Then ON is the next diagram. So, this is how you split the given plain text. So, given a plain text, you will be splitting them into groups of 2 characters. And if there are any repeating characters in a particular group, then you will be putting a filler for that, and then only you will be categorizing the remaining letters. And finally, for the last diagram, you don't have a pair, you will be just fitting in XY, bogus letters. Okay, that's the first rule. Then, if both the letters fall in the same row, then you have to replace each with the letter to the right of it. That is, give an example, AR. Look at AR. That is, I have a plain text, and in that plain text, one diagram is AR. So what will I substitute AR with? Look at the position of AR. A and R, they occupy the same row. So what I do is, I'll be substituting each character with the character on the right. Because as a result also, I want two characters. So what I do is, A is substituted with R. And who is residing on right of R? I'll be going in a circular manner. So the right element of R is M. So basically, AR is substituted with RM. Okay. Now suppose I am having a plain text ON, on. Okay. Then what will I do? O and N, it comes in the same row. So I'll be substituting with the character to the right of it. So O will be substituted with N and N will be substituted with A. Okay. Similarly, if I am taking P and S, see PS is a diagram in plain text. Then P will be substituted with Q, S will be substituted with T. So this is rule number two. Another possibility is if both letters fall in the same column, then replace each with the letter below it. So here also you will be having the wrapping issue, because what is the letter that is to the downside of U? You will be again going back to this one, M. So an example is MU. Look at MU diagram. M is here and U is here. They fall in the same column. So you will be replacing them with the character to the downside of that. So M is replaced with C and U is replaced with the character below it, means M. You're considering it as a cyclic one. Suppose you have YQ. Suppose YQ was a plain text. They both fall in the same column. So what will you substitute with? YQ is substituted with GW. Okay. So that is rule number two. So if two letters, they fall in the same row, and if two letters, they fall in the same column, what do you have to do? Now, the next possibility is, suppose you have a case where each letter, they do not fall in the same row or column. Then you have to look at the intersection part. So an example that I could give you is, say, H and S. Okay, look at H. H falls here. You can go for highlighter. So H falls here and S falls here, right? So they neither belong to the same row or same column. So what you have to do is, you will be taking the intersecting point of H and S. So H should be substituted with that element in its row which intersects with the next element. So H and S, they intersect at this point, right? It is in the same row as H. So H will be replaced by B. Now, what will you replace S with? So what you do is, what is the intersecting point of S and H? What is the intersecting point? This P is the intersecting point that lies in the same row as S. So S will be replaced by okay. So if each letter, if they do not fall in the same row or same column, each letter is replaced by the letter that lies in its own row and the column occupied by the other letter of the pair. Okay. I'll give you another example. Another example is EA. Okay. Where is E? E is in this part. Then A is in this part. So they do not fall in the same row or column. So what you substitute with this? E will be substituted with the element in the same row that intersects with the column of the other letter, that is A. So you have I and J. You can use any character. E can be replaced by I or J. Okay, now what will I replace A with? I'll be taking the row that intersects with E. See this one. And when I have the element M that intersects with this E. So I'll have to substitute that element with the element or the letter that lies in its own row and the column occupied by the other letter. So EA becomes IM or JM, since I and J occupy the same position. Okay. So this is how a Playfair cipher works. Okay. It's a relatively good cipher. The security is much improved because an attacker has to deal with digrams, that is two characters. So a total of 26 into 26 digrams have to be dealt with. And that was the strength of the cipher. Okay. So to summarize with, here we have considered some classical cipher techniques and terminology. Then we have studied monoalphabetic substitution ciphers. Then cryptanalysis using letter frequencies, which was a drawback of monoalphabetic, and also a Playfair cipher. So in the next part, we'll be continuing with remaining substitution ciphers, Hill ciphers, Wigner cipher, one-time pad, and we'll also be discussing the second classical encryption technique, which is called the transposition technique. So hope you have understood the topics taken in this session. So, thank you.